the point, ladies and gentlemen. Admiral Sunil Lanba, former Chairman, Chief of Staff Committee and Chief of Naval Staff. General Bipin Rawat, Chief of Army Staff. Mr. Sardari Lal, brother of Colonel Karalal and Mr. Sardari Lal, Air Chief Marshal Tyagi, members of the USI Council, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's indeed a great privilege for me to welcome you to the 23rd Colonel Karalal Memorial Lecture. The subject for this talk was selected by the USI Council almost a year ago, and we looked at the subject. If you look at the subject, it's very interesting. It looks at building military capabilities, developing new partnerships, protecting national interests in an uncertain world order. So there's nothing left out. It's actually looking at India's national interest in today's scenario and then saying what are the capabilities we need to build military capabilities. And we also realize that we cannot do anything and everything alone. So we're also looking around at the model that we should have for partnerships. So that is basically the theme of today's lecture. For the benefit of those who may not know, Colonel Karalal, in whose abiding memory these lectures have been instituted by a generous grant given by the family, was the head of the institution for 30 years. From 1957 till 1987, he was the director, secretary, editor. As a matter of fact, I would go on to say he was the institution for those 30 years. If we talked about the USI, you talked about Colonel Karalal. That was what it was. He put his, if somebody was to ask me what was, I think for him, USI was something very dear to him. I first met him when I applied for my correspondence course for the staff college. And that was the first meeting that I had with him. And of course, thanks to the excellent material and guidance given by the USI, I did get a competitive vacancy. But he, thereafter, he used to keep a track of all of us who did got through the staff college and got posted to Delhi. And he came to my office, I was a lieutenant colonel posted in the MS branch, he came to my office to say, hey, I remember you did the course, I remember you got through, now it's payback time. So you please come and set the paper and correct the papers. So for 3 years, I set papers for the correspondence course and did the correction work. That was him. I mean, he would come to your office to reach out to you. He did not stand on formality to say that he is commissioned in 1943, he is very senior, he is head of an institution. No, he didn't have all that. Actually, he had, for the members, it was all that he had was how to help, how to guide, how to share with the people. That was Colonel Karalal. I can go on and on, but and actually most of you can who have known him longer than I have known him. But I would like to say that the USI owes a lot to him, to his dedication, to his commitment to the institution. And the council very aptly named the USI library as the Colonel Karalal Memorial Library. That's the most apt recognition because that is where the knowledge resides. So it's his, the library is named after him. For this morning's talk, we have the former Chief of Naval Staff and former Chairman, Chief of Staff Committee, Admiral Sunil Lanba. I must say he was very gracious to accept my request to come and give this talk after demitting office. And I got hold of him, or we got hold of him before he left the office. And he very graciously agreed and gave us a date. And thank you very much, sir, for that. It was indeed very kind of you. I got to know the Admiral when he was Commandant of the National Defense College. And he helped the USI connect with the National Defense College, and we used to conduct the strategic gaming exercises over there. The Admiral has had an excellent track record. Obviously, if you become a chief, you have an excellent track record. He was commissioned in 1978. Apart from being the Commandant of the National Defense College, he was also the CNC of two naval commands. He was the Vice Chief of Naval Staff, and thereafter he was the Chief of Naval Staff. He heads the National Maritime Foundation now. He'll be speaking to us on the subject, as I mentioned. It's a difficult subject, but I'm sure it's going to make it interesting and easy for all of us to follow. This morning's session, we have General Bipin Rawat, the Chief of the Army Staff, as our guest of honor. I must again thank the Chief for very graciously accepting our invitation to be here, to be present here, to be the guest of honor, and for accepting to deliver the concluding remarks. I know how busy the Chief is, especially at this time of the year. and but yet to spare half a day virtually to be here is extremely nice of him. We are grateful to you. My contact with the general began many years ago when I was a colonel in the staff college, and the general was a student at the staff college, and I have known him since then. The general has commanded a battalion on the line of actual control. He commanded the RR sector and a division in JNK, and he commanded 3 Corps in the east. He was also the army commander of Southern Command and vice chief of the army staff. And thereafter, he has become the chief of the army staff. What is not normally known is that he also has a PhD. So it's not, and I must give him full marks. I dropped out of the PhD, didn't have the stamina to push through. But I must say that despite all his commitments, he did find time and he's done his PhD. Once again, thank you very much to both of you for being here. And as the form is, the Admiral will speak for 45 minutes to an hour. There is no time limit. And thereafter, he will take questions. And after that, General Rawat will very graciously use accepted to deliver the concluding remarks. Over to Admiral Lanba.
General Bipin Rawat, the Chief of Army Staff, members of Colonel Pyarelal's family, Air Chief Marshal Tyagi, the former Chief of Air Staff, members of the USI Council, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to all of you. At the outset, I'd like to thank the Director USI for having invited me to deliver the 23rd Colonel Pyarelal Memorial Lecture. It's indeed a privilege for me to address such a distinguished gathering today morning. The topic chosen for the lecture is of considerable current interest, which is why I greatly value this opportunity given to me to share my thoughts on the subject. The strategic need for the nation to protect and promote their national interest in a changing world order has been the centerpiece of global strategic discourse for some time now. Linked to this aspect of national interest is the need to build one military capability to prepare for the array of security challenges that lie ahead, and also the aspect of developing new partnerships as the global order shifts from a unipolar world to a multipolar one. As security practitioners, I think there is little dispute over the assertion that the world today is characterized by multi-layered, multifaceted diversity from political, demographic, economic, environmental, and strategic viewpoints. But why are these times so important from a strategic perspective? That is largely because everything around us seems to indicate that the world is another period of historical transition. And therefore, I believe it would be a fair assumption that we are indeed living through a period of strategic uncertainty. But it is this, a phase in which unprecedented in modern history, or something which is unique to our time, well, that may require us to dive deeper into the past. But before I get going, I would briefly introduce to you the broad structure in which I would cover the subject under discussion today morning. I would start my talk today by introducing the present-day world order and the challenges and opportunities which it offers. In this aspect, I would also dwell upon the issue of uncertainty, global power competition, and the so-called new normal, which are evolving as center stage discussion of all strategic discourse of our current times. Later, I'll take a broad look at protecting national interests in this changing world order and the importance of investing in building credible military capability for the future. Then I would shed some light on how collaborative partnerships can shape national and regional dynamics, particularly in an environment of uncertainty. Here, I would also highlight the umbilical link between trusted partnerships and national security in the emerging world order. And finally, I'll share my thoughts on certain germane issues that could shape the future military capability roadmap through new partnerships as a collective endeavor towards protecting national interests. Ladies and gentlemen, it may not be wrong to assume that a perfectly stable world order is a rare thing. As a matter of fact, in search for parallels to today's world, scholars and practitioners have looked as far as ancient Greece, where a rise of a new power resulted in a war between Athens and Sparta. The global order which we live in today is widely believed to have been built in the aftermath of the Second World War. Broadly speaking, this order consists of two parallel orders for most of its history. One grew out of the Cold War between the United States and the then Soviet Union, and the other was the liberal order, which used aid and trade to strengthen ties and foster respect for the rule of law both within and between countries. Tacking to the present time, today's competition between China and the United States is a new twist to an old story. Until the onset of the 19th century, China was by far the largest world economy, with an estimated 40% share of the world's GDP. Then it entered a long decline, and around the same time, the United States was born and began its long ascent to global dominance. So both countries have dominated the world. Each has had its own strengths and weaknesses, and for the first time, they confirmed each other as near peer. It is too soon to tell how the innings ahead will be played out, but we can be confident that the game will continue, and as the world moves from an earlier unipolar to a bipolar, or a bipolar to a multipolar one. Here I would urge the strategic thinkers to plan or to maintain a long view and not be overly influenced by small term changes. This is particularly important since there is a tendency to view development over the last few years as the sign of an ellipse of the so-called stable world order. But in my opinion, that would be a mistake. Although the recent challenges should not be underestimated, it is important to recognize that they are closer to the rule than the exception. Great power rivalry is indeed the motor of history, and we shall have to protect our core interests in this phase also. I am sure by now you would agree that the power diffusion which we are witnessing is not a new or a unique phenomenon. But at the same time, we need to brace ourselves for the diverse array of strategic challenges which may lie ahead. Many of these would have direct bearing on national as well as regional security calculus. But for that, we need to accurately assess as to where does India fit into this new normal. Well, this is where, in my opinion, the present phase is different from the earlier one. While geopolitical rivalries and the quest for global dominance may have been a signature phenomena of the entire modern era, it is probably for the first time that we are sitting astride the center stage of power competition, that of the Indo-Pacific. Ladies and gentlemen, we would agree that the 21st century has witnessed an eastward shift in the locus of global geopolitics and economic power play. In recent times, the idea of Indo-Pacific has gained immense importance in international geopolitics. Given that the arterial trade and energy routes originating and passing through the region, several major players are making long-term investments to protect their energy interests hinging on this region. As an example to highlight the region's growing geostrategic importance, it is interesting to note about 80% of trade originating from here is actually extra-regional. Unhindered flow of maritime trade through the Indo-Pacific region has assumed tremendous significance for the entire world. Further, it is in pure economic terms, the Indo-Pacific region contributes about 60% of global GDP and is home to 4 of the top 10 economies of the world. In the military context, the region is home to the 10 largest standing armies in the world and 7 of the top 10 countries in terms of global military expenditure. and the rising military power of the region has come to complicate the security calculus in many ways. So as we can infer, the geostrategic imminence of the Indo-Pacific region is here to stay. In the foreseeable future, the region would play a pivotal role in shaping the global economic and strategic paradigm. It is here that India has a definite role to play in shaping the future world order. And as we can see, there is a renewed interest from the world to engage with India in this region as a strategic need to preserve peace, promote stability, and maintain security across the Indo-Pacific is no longer a regional necessity, but indeed a global imperative. It is this feature which, in my opinion, makes the present time different from earlier ones, especially from an Indian perspective. We have the opportunity to play a central role in the primary theater of geostrategic competition. Moving on, of course, this uncertain world order affects India in profound ways. The challenge which it brings along are well known, but I also see the critical need to see the strategic opportunities which these tectonic shifts bring or offer. These opportunities cover the entire spectrum of global interaction, most prominent of them being economic, trade, technological, and the military domains. The growing stature and the clout of India affords us a unique moment in history to play a major role in shaping the collective future of the world. Given the fact that by 2024, India is estimated to have a $5 trillion economy, the jury is still out, there are a lot of discussions going on this figure, it is but natural that we would have to assume leadership roles in global affairs, the sign of which are already there on the horizon. We are better positioned to influence the new global and regional institutions that are being created. The attributes of a strong economy, robust governance, and superior military provides us the prospect of reserving our seat on the table which nurture and shape the future world order. Having spoken about the changing world order and the role India could play in it, I will now shift to the core of my talk today, which centers around the aspect of protecting our national interests in this uncertain world order, and which, in my opinion, form the nucleus of all our future endeavors. It goes without saying that the one and only driving factor of all our present and future endeavors will be national interests. In fact, every measure we initiate should have this facet at its very core. Having said that, I strongly believe that safeguarding and promoting these interests would require, as we say in the Navy, a whole ship approach. Every arm of the government, be it finance, foreign policy, defense, trade, commerce, or technology, all will have to work in unison to keep India's national interests safe and secure in these contested times. While each enabler supports our national interests in myriad ways, a secure internal and external security environment provided by the military and other agencies facilitate growth and development of the nation. Be it on land, in the air, or the maritime theater, a benign environment is a catalyst for national progress. Speaking in pure military terms, this will require building deterrence, both conventional and nuclear, protecting our sovereignty in all domains, as well as maintaining a credible presence in all our areas of interest. Here two aspects would merit consideration towards gearing for the future. Firstly, it would be important for us to anticipate change, and we would need to do it well. Change in the color and shades of warfare will have to be acutely anticipated along with response mechanisms. It can be safely assumed that the time ahead is going to be different from the past. The rapidity which events may escalate into front-borne conflicts cannot be overemphasized. As you have seen during the Balakot strike earlier this year, a decisive, swift and calibrated response can lead to significant strategic gains. Therefore, our institutional capacity to anticipate change across theaters would need to be of a very high order. This may also require a relook at our structures and processes, followed by corresponding recalibration to keep pace with changing times. Secondly, we would also need to have an over-the-horizon approach towards our military capability building. By this, I mean that investing in developing futuristic technologies, achieving self-reliance in defense production should be high on our order of priority list. While a lot has been achieved in the past few years, sustained development of all stakeholders, including government, military, the public sector, R&D organization, and more importantly, the private sector, including the MSMEs, would be essential to pursue this line of effort. In fact, achieving self-reliance in defense production, particularly in the field of niche technologies, should be a national mission. As we progress along this vision, partnering with like-minded countries would also play a key role, since both the aspects which I just highlighted, that of adopting changes and capability building, would prosper well when followed through a collaborated route. But before I highlight the various ways in which we can leverage partnerships, I will briefly develop on certain key aspects which merit consideration in this regard. Ladies and gentlemen, I am of the firm belief that one of the most important lessons for us in this era of multipolarity is the growing relevance of regional balance and constellations. In this era of issue-based convergence seems to be the new norm in order to balance converging and conflicting interests. This means differences with partners on a certain issue should not obviate the scope of our mutual cooperation in other avenues. Ladies and gentlemen, we cannot afford to be caught flat-footed by dogma, prejudices, and obsolete theories. When you look at the world, we have an open-minded approach and allow us to pursue different approaches with different partners. For example, we may increase the tempo of our engagement with certain long-cherished partners. We may also need to manage our relationship with others simultaneously. At the same time, we also need to cultivate and enthuse new partners, and therefore a one size fit all approach may not serve our purpose in the coming terms. It is important that every partnership, both existing ones as well as those on the anvil, are optimally leveraged for mutual growth. Distilling these thoughts into the military aspect, I see several opportunities for India to engage with the world, particularly in the aspect of capability and capacity building. With our robust defense structures supported by credible multi-domain proficiency, we are well placed to play a central role in pursuing government's foreign policy initiatives through military-to-military engagements. And here I must add that several important policy initiatives have been introduced in the past few years, which have collectively enabled greater military interaction with our partner states. In this era of intertwined interests and challenges, it is imperative that we look at leveraging military partnerships as an essential enabler for pursuing and promoting our national security objectives. And these partnerships not only offer an array of tangible benefits ranging from operational to capability building, but most importantly, they allow us to hedge against diverse security concerns which pose serious challenges to the collective security. Let me amplify as to how some of our trusted partnerships have contributed towards protecting our national interests in present times. The Foundation security agreements have enabled sharing of resources and information in pursuance of national security interests. For example, the landmark conclusion of COMCASA last year allows utilization of US-based encryption technology for communication instead of using commercially available technologies. It allows means of communication, sharing of information, having a common picture available across the areas of interest. Similarly, dedicated logistic sharing agreements like LIMOVA allows us to mutually benefit through optimal utilization of each other's logistic facilities covered under the provision of agreements. Like if you take a Navy specific case of Lanba, you can fuel with the US tankers anywhere in the world, and at the end of the year you settle your bills. If our tankers are available, their ships can fuel from our tankers. It's already been practiced now for a number of years, and after signing of Lanba, this has been initiative where naval ships have fueled in the Pacific, in the Med, in the Gulf of Aden. Another example is HOSTAC agreement, which the Navy signed last year. This enables Indian naval helicopters to land on the deck of ships of over 50 navies and Coast Guard, significantly enhancing operational interoperability between countries. Military engagements can also contribute towards new capacity building initiatives, particularly as joint development projects on advanced technologies. BrahMos offers one such shining example, where a trusted military partnership translated into tangible technological products available to both countries. Similarly, collaboration with Israel on such products also substantiates this argument. We've had a long development of the MRSAM, which has been jointly inducted into both the armed forces. In this regard, I must also make a specific mention of how important military acquisitions benefit from direct government-to-government or G2G agreements. In our context, the Navy's multi-role helicopter, the Air Force Rafale fighter, and the Army's AK-203 assault rifles have all been possible because of robust intergovernmental partnerships. Another important contribution of military partnership is its role in enhancing regional security environment. Here I can think of no better example than the Indian Ocean Naval Symposium, an initiative of the Indian Navy. Started as a regional maritime security initiative in 2008, IONS within a short span of a decade has evolved into a leading maritime organization of the Indian Ocean region with 24 members and 8 observer states. In fact, the forum today not only addresses regional and even sub-regional issues, but also focuses on important security disciplines such as maritime security, HADR, information sharing, and interoperability. And it's moved on from just talks to actual exercises on ground, both at sea and in HADR. And lastly, the cyber domain emergence as a fifth theater of war warrants us to look at this aspect with serious thought and focus. The cyber domain today has transcended national boundaries, acquiring a hybrid and transnational character. It poses serious security challenges to law enforcement agencies, including those of legal jurisdiction, authority, and penalties. An effective mechanism to monitor this domain would warrant a multilateral initiative, further highlighting the need of trusted partnerships. Ladies and gentlemen, with that as a backdrop, I would share my opinion on three essential ingredients for developing a military capability and nurturing partnerships as an enabler to protecting our national interests in present times. And I do hope that by charting a course around these three waypoints, we will be able to better prepare for the future. Firstly, I believe that optimization of resources should be high on our collective agenda. Given the diverse nature of socioeconomic challenges which our country faces, resource availability to meet the national security needs would continue to be a challenge. Also, given the fact that capability building and force sustenance are expensive propositions, we need to look at innovative ways and measures to enhance sharing of our resources. It is prudent that every rupee committed towards building military should give the nation manifold returns from that. The services would have to institutionally address this issue of optimization. In this regard, I must share that much progress has been made in recent times with the establishment of the Joint Logistic Node, joint training institutions, which were raised with the primary aim of optimizing resources. But a lot still needs to be done in this aspect, and I am confident that the three armed forces will accord its required impetus, and the appointment of the CDS would also be able to drive this process forward. And if it is required, we can discuss this during the Q&A. The second aspect is the need to focus on our effort on achieving self-reliance in defense production particularly in the field of core technologies involving weapons, sensors and propulsion system. I think one of the core technologies which we really need to concentrate on is aero engines. That is something which even China is struggling with, and once China masters and makes a capable aero engine, we are in trouble. It is important to note self-reliance in defense production provides the country with the immense flexibility to commit resources in a calibrated manner and to modify and customize the deliverables to the requirement of times. In other words, it gives us strategic independence. In the absence of it, our dependence on external factors would continue, limiting our strategic choice in the future. And lastly, we must work towards leveraging our partnership for enhancing interoperability between militaries of the region, which to me should be one of our key military priorities. Given the dynamic and diverse nature of challenges which the region faces today, it would be imperative to maintain a high degree of military-to-military cooperation along with enhanced interoperability. I also feel a strong need to focus our effort on establishing robust, reliable and real-time information sharing mechanisms with partner states. This aspect assumes special significance given the speed at which local security threats can assume a national, regional or even a global character. Information sharing, therefore, is not only essential but in fact foundational to defending collective security interests. Here I would like to share the example of the Information Fusion Center for the Indian Ocean Region of the Indian Navy, which was commissioned in December 2018 to further our commitment towards achieving collective maritime security in the IOR. Given the facility's significant potential in enhancing the security quotient of the entire Indian Ocean region, 20 countries and one multilateral national construct are already partnering with Indian Navy initiative, making it a one-time convergence center for the entire Indian Ocean region's maritime activity. The center brings out a fortnightly bulletin which is shared with everybody who are the members of this initiative. It brings out what are the merchant navy traffic, what are the ships, what is fishing, what is illegal fishing going on, and this information is available across to all partner systems. This collaborative initiative highlights the tangible gains derived from trusted partnerships. Well, to conclude, I will say that the deterioration of the world order today can set in motion a trend that spells trouble. What we are seeing today resembles the mid-19th century in important ways, but I strongly believe that the world is not yet on the edge of a systemic crisis. It is upon those in the policy making to make sure that the crisis never materializes, be it as an outcome of competing interests, hyper-nationalism, or even as a cumulative effort of climate change. All I can say that even in an uncertain world, a collective endeavor should be to aim for a certain future. Let me also express my conviction that protecting our core national interests would warrant us to keep pace with the changing times, adapt to the evolving geostrategic canvas, and most importantly, anticipate change and prepare for it. Building inclusive partnerships, in my view, is an essential prerequisite to shape a positive national future for global good. With deep muted trust and confidence, a calmer future awaits us. In this regard, the Honorable Prime Minister's mantras of 5S, which elaborates the view of Samman, Samvad, Sayog, Shanti and Simriddhi, aptly indicates a resolve to change, to engage with the world for a shared future. In this quest, developing a new partnership in the region and beyond with like-minded partners can only be an influence for good, both for internal as well as external security dynamics. As how we garner the strength from a collaborative partnership and bind together with the world remains fundamentally important in maintaining strategic equilibrium of our national security environment. I am of the firm conviction that the future of the global order hinges on a collaborative effort, and India has a pivotal role to play in it. In the end, thanks once again for giving me this opportunity, and I wish USI continued success in all its future endeavors. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we will open up for the question and answer session. Please introduce yourself and pose your questions or comments. The floor is, the house is open now. Commander Batra is the first one who's.
Capability already exists in certain fields. We have already supplied build ships for Sri Lanka, for Mauritius. We are already partnering with shipyards in Bangladesh to jointly build ships. We are also in dialogue with Myanmar to build this. So capability exists. Yes, there is no, in certain areas, in certain avenues, there is no capacity. Okay. Like if you are locking off aviation platforms in the form of helicopters and fighter aircrafts, there is no capacity to supply to partner countries if you want, even if you want to do that. Okay, at the moment, HAL doesn't have the capacity to ramp up, say if you want to look at the LCA or the Tejas and you want to give it. The present capability and capacity of HL, which is just 8 aircrafts a year, which is now being ramped up to 16, is too small to supply. So we need to have a holistic view on this, where you want to develop, have an ecosystem where you have export or defense hardware, which we lack at the moment. We have not done this in the past, and there is still work in progress to get a process in place of how you're going to this. Most of the biggest challenge is the entire ecosystem is based on public sector, DPSUs or the PSUs, and they are a captive customer in the form of the armed forces. None of them have a robust marketing division. If you want to be a global exporter, you need a robust marketing setup in any company, which all the DPSUs in the lack. So you'll have to set up a marketing division to market your product and also put in the capability and the capacity to produce, to supply, after me having the capability and capacity to meet our own needs.
Okay. Yes, please. Okay.
Sir, I'm Lieutenant Colonel Mohit Nayar. I'm with the National Maritime Foundation. My question gets provoked with building military capabilities. One of the most upcoming technological challenge which is there for the armed forces is the artificial intelligence. Now, if you look at the Russians, they're going for robotic army. You look at the world over, it's a major budget emphasis given to artificial intelligence. So has the government of India aligned itself to artificial intelligence for military? And I'm sure IDS is working on that. My question is that a lot of innovations which are taking place are at a very fast pace in artificial intelligence. And much work is also being done in civil setups. There was a time when whatever military used to produce as military technology was later utilized by the civil agencies. However, today, that amalgamation has to be very fast, meaning that whatever is being developed in the civil setup has to be utilized by the army and vice versa. So are we having some mechanisms coming up in future where this technological challenge can be met with a better coordination with the civil agencies as of now? Do we have some plan or some thinking on that? Thank you, sir.
Okay. Work has already been done on AI. There was a committee headed by the chairman of TCS, which was set up and looked at it, I think, 3 years ago. Yes. It came out, the committee submitted reports. It also had members from the three armed forces. Some way heads were recommended by the committee. The three service headquarters have identified the avenues and they are in engagement, because the capability rests outside the military in the form of the IT industry in our country, and work is already on. In the Navy's case, which I am familiar with, there were three or four core areas of AI which were identified. The Navy is already in dialogue with certain private sector companies to develop the way ahead. So it is already work in progress. Okay. Sure.
Mike, just take Mike.
Just to add more, just to give some information here. There is a DIDCC, Defense Industrial Technical Cooperation Mechanism, which meets twice a year. The CISC is the vice chairman, and we are coordinating all these technical areas where there is a lot of scope in the military, but there is adequate amount of research in the civil. So AI is one of them. There are several other fields, just to answer you. So IITs, the corporate houses, and the military requirement. So this is what happens. You get more because there are more graduate reserves.
General Sani, please. I'll get back to you. Be careful this. Better than this, sir.
Thank you very much for a very perceptive talk. I just wanted to highlight an issue and seek your comments on that. You said that G2G has been extremely fruitful as far as building our capabilities are concerned, which I think is absolutely right. But I think for the overall development of capability within the country, it is important that the private sector gets involved. So the present state of our MSMEs are basically as feeders to the DPSU. So they individually, they still do not have feet to stand on. So the more and more that we go into G2G options and look at the PSUs as the strategic developer of weapon systems, oblique platforms, you will never get into the capability development. So I think this dichotomy will have to be addressed, because politically it is expedient to take the G2G way out, because then you're not under any flag. But really, to develop the country tomorrow, whether it's aero engines, whether you're looking at platforms for the land forces, you will have to look at getting the private sector involved. So I think this balance needs to be looked at, and somehow if you could address how you are tackling this or how you looked at it, we'd be delighted to hear that. Thank you.
When you look back, what the ecosystem which exists in the MOD is the majority of defense procurement were done through public sector units and the DPSUs. Okay. Let me take a specific example of the Navy's case, where
there was limited capacity of shipbuilding within the defense shipyards, and we had pushed this case for opening up naval shipbuilding to private sector shipyards. It took Herculean effort and time to get the ministry on board. They finally came on board, and we gave or signed the first lot of contracts sometime in 2005-2006. Then the great world financial crisis happened in 2007-8, and the private shipyard, Indian private shipyards, there were four of them. All of them today are all belly up. So one is the process and the appetite within the ministry of engaging with the private sector, which is something new. Okay. But over the last 5-6 years, this has changed. There is appetite within the ministry to engage with the private sector and open up defense procurement and development. So the DPM and the DPP have been modified and changed their different models of MiG-2 and all that. Then we had a strategic partnership. It took
system quite a long time to come out with the formulation of the strategic partnership. And the first few cases of the strategic partnership are now in the process of moving forward. The last I know, there were two naval cases of the naval utility helicopter and the submarine. This is the first two strategic partnerships which are off the block. It's not going to be an easy process to do the strategic partnership. The crux will come when you have to select the strategic partners. The other is from the private sector perspective itself, this is my personal viewpoint, is they need to have a long-term view. When you're getting into defense equipment manufacture and supply, you need to be able to support that it's an entire life cycle. The general private sector companies have a very short-term view and they're out to make quick profits. Therefore, that is also changing, where larger companies have come in and have been working along with. So it's a work in progress, and I'm quite confident that the private sector is going to be involved in a much larger degree in the coming decade than what it is today. And there is appetite within the ministry to engage and change the process to get them on board. And that is the way ahead. That's not really the case, sir. Each service has its own perspective. No, there's success stories in all the three services. And like I recently read about the bulletproof jacket, which now is being coming up into the private sector. Okay, it's a small baby step which is being made. But even when you look at large systems, say like you take the tanks or this thing, a lot of components which go into the tank is made by private sector. It's not only, okay, the assembler or the main this thing, maybe a DPSU. But the core support is going into the larger systems, like even the ships. There are very large segment of the private sector involvement in the building and construction and supplying of modules and other subsystems which go into the ship. So there is a degree of involvement.
Like now at the moment, the Project 17 Alpha frigate construction project is being made in an integrated modular construction format, where both the Mazagon Dock Shipyard and Garden Reach, which are building the ships, have sublet modules construction to private sector shipyards. So that's already happening. So this is a process which is going, and it's only going to expand.
Sir, I just get that, General B.K. Sharma, then I'll come back to you, sir.
My question pertains to the phase of conflicts which we are witnessing in the Indo-Pacific and particularly in the Indian Ocean region now. And we've seen post-Bombay attacks, now large number of attacks by non-state actors and state-sponsored non-state actors are actually taking place. Now, I would just request you to elaborate what is India's position in regard to integrated evaluation of threats and response mechanism, particularly in the light of what lessons we learned during Bombay and post Bombay, whatever you know measures we have taken to address, are there still certain adequacies and how are we working on this?
Basically, you're alluding to India and the coastal security issues. There are multiple agencies which are involved in coastal security. It is also an issue between center and state, and the concurrent list which rests with the center, which rests with the state. Okay. But we have come a long way since 2611. Methods have been put in place.
the capability of the Indian Coast Guard in the last one decade has really been beefed up. A lot of money has been invested. Their capabilities, they've grown almost three times what they were earlier. The Navy has been overall, the Chief of Naval Staff is overall responsible for coastal security. He may be responsible, but the 17 or 19 agencies are not accountable to him. That is a challenge which is there. I'm not denying the fact. But the whole system of information sharing, networking, operations like IMAC in Delhi, all the radars which are there in the coastal chain, the first phase which had 40 odd radars, the second phase is now being executed. So the entire coast has been mapped. The Navy and the Coast Guard every year does a survey of all the fishing villages along the coast, so that data is available. Is the system perfect? No, it's still work in progress, because a lot of things which need to be done by the states, which are not really, some states have done a fairly good job, like Gujarat and Tamil Nadu have done a pretty decent job of putting infrastructure in place and the systems in place. Others have been quite, especially on the East Coast, West Bengal, which have been quite lackluster in their attitude and going on. Like Maharashtra also needs to do a much better job. We are much better prepared. Intelligence input sharing is more robust. The operational picture which is available is there, which all inputs from all agencies, including satellite, AIS, radars, available, and that is shared. Your mute point is whether we will be able to prevent a similar attack which took place in Mumbai. A lot will depend on the intelligence input and the actionable intelligence input which comes in. Okay, I hope I answered your question.
Sir, here, my friend, here. On your left, the mic is there. Mic is there, sir.
Thank you, Jim. Taking you back, I think it's high time that the private sector participation actually fructified as far as the defense production is concerned.
I can't agree with you, Mosi.
What started in 2001, it's taken us so many years. I do hope that it has crossed the threshold now. And where I get this hope is, because I understand that as far as the HCA is concerned now, that HCA is going to become the integrator, and they are going to actually outsource the building of the front fuselage, the rear fuselage, and the wings to private men. So that brings me back to this question, a specific question to you, sir. On the Naval NCA, you know, just a couple of weeks ago, there was very heartening news that the Naval NCA actually carried out a simulated arrestor landing.
Actual arrestor landing.
Actual. But not on the ship, but actually it was on the runway. And there are fears about putting to be tried out even on high respect. But I remember some time ago, I mean some years ago, when the Navy had categorically rejected the Naval NCA for not meeting its operational requirements. Would you like to throw some light on it as to which way are we going?
I only made that statement, sir. Okay. That was in December 2016, I remember, in the Navy Day press conference. If you go back in the history of the LCA, the first service which committed to the LCA was the Indian Navy. The Air Force came on later. The LCA Navy, in its present form, is not a deck-based fighter. You need a deck-based fighter needs to take off from the deck of the aircraft carrier with fuel and weapon. And should have a radius of action to deliver the ordnance. Whether you utilize it in the form of air defense or attack ashore. Unfortunately, the power to weight ratio of the LCA Navy doesn't facilitate him doing either. He can take off with the fuel and with no weapon, so that doesn't serve. So it's not really a deck-based fighter. So the way we have worked out with, and where the LCA Navy has reached today and this first arrested landing which took place on the STBH facility at INS Hansa in Goa has primarily been because the Navy has been pushing this for a number of years. So the present LCA Navy is a technology demonstrator which now has demonstrated all the technologies including the arrestor hook and the landing system and the undercarriage and all that. And now we are committed to the next generation fighter which the DRDO is going to develop, which is hopefully should result in a proper deck-based fighter, an indigenous deck-based fighter. And I couldn't agree with you more that there is need to be a robust involvement of the private sector. And it's happening, say like if you take the case of the army, a lot of the artillery systems and new guns have been developed by the private sector and now they are in the process of undergoing trials, which I think most of them have succeeded, and army chief can throw more light. And they are now going to be inducted in large numbers in the Indian Army. Unfortunately, for the in the Navy, the case of shipbuilding, we had a quite a poor experience with private sector shipyards. We signed contracts, two of them are closed down. One at the moment is with the, what is the right word to use? NL. So it's also under arbitration and is in court. It is broke, to put it in simple words. And the three services are quite open to the idea of engaging and recruiting equipment from the private sector. And in my opinion, that is the way.
General
Dua,
please. Then I'll come to Admiral Chopra. I've got the sequence, I'll get that to you. Please,
thank you, sir. I'll just start off with what you spoke about India's emerging importance. Please bear with me for just about 1 minute. I'll give a very different view to it. Now, and that's to drive home, I want to come to that. So the issue is, when you say that today the world is recognizing our importance, I'll put it in a different way. When our Prime Minister can go and meet the US leadership, the French leadership, and the Russian leadership in quick succession, is it only because of our increasing importance, strategic importance, etc., the strategic location, etc., or is it because we are, Saudi Arabia said, the largest importer of defense equipment in the foreseeable future, and with money to pay for it? We are actually buying a lot of equipment, and we've been speaking about this, we are importing a lot of equipment. This is the thing that I think we need to leverage to get to a point which you been speaking, others have been are talking about, is getting them to manufacture more and more in India while we have to procure. I do realize that I am repeating some of the issues that have been raised over here, but instead of, let's say, Air Force, you mentioned that yourself in the past itself, instead of different agencies, the DPSU, the other agencies, trying to continue to do R&D on the same things. Today, if we are going to, in the next 10 years, if the civil aviation and the Air Force put together are going to buy a humongous number of aircraft in the next decades. If we put these things together, anybody to come and set shop over here, Boeing is set shop in China for this particular purpose. So, in continuation with what General Sani said, my request is that the government should get a little more comfortable in trying to get away from the PSUs only. Let me take this example of rifles. There was a perfect case where we could have also given business to the private industry, maybe in addition to the ordnance factories, because there is a huge market. This is not a rocket technology, I agree. But the fact is, these are the things that we need to take ahead. And I would now urge you with the same thing that General Sani ended with. Maybe this is what needs to be influenced, or this is what needs to be impressed upon the powers to be. We need to get away from the government sector as much as possible. The strategic partnership, two examples that you quoted, are really less. And actually, sir, when we speak about this, we know the progress is slow. Let us not, pardon my saying so, Army Chief is saying, let us not walk out bulletproof jackets. That's too small a thing. And if we could not get up there for 15 years, I become a ready to retire time. We have
Your basic point is involvement of the private sector. Okay, you gave the example of the assault rifle. You have to take a holistic picture, and say, let's limit ourselves to the assault rifle itself. You have a huge ordnance factory board with the infrastructure which is in place. With a very large sum of money which is invested primarily by the army in supporting that structure, it employs how many lakhs of people. Now it will be quite naive on our part if you think that the government, or you can wish away the OFB in its entirety. Okay. I agree with you, it's a most inefficient organization, and right, the right places the OFB should be shut shop. Okay. And you can sell it off to the private sector, that is the way ahead. But let's be practical, it's not going to happen. Okay. No government of the day is going to take this decision. Then what do you do? Okay. So you need to engage with them. Okay. I know a big debate on this assault rifle took place. Okay. Manjeev and me knew what the discussion, we are not at liberty to share with, and how this decision was taken to give this particular case to the OFB. Okay. So we'll have to continue to be engaged with the Ordnance Factory Board. Okay. But gradually we have been moving away. There also now a process has been set in place to improve efficiencies of that. But I entirely agree with you and General Soni that we need to engage with the private sector, and that I am quite open in mind, that is the way ahead. Okay. But then you have horror stories like, say, shipbuilding. When you made out a case, it's flopped and failed entirely. Now when you go back and say, see, you guys only pushed it, what's happened? Okay. But I am quite sure with now the whole lot of top class private sector firms which have come in into defense manufacturing, that is aware, and I am quite sure there's 4 or 5 large companies which are there will produce the goods and meet our requirements, and that is the way ahead.
Admiral Chopra.
Thank you.
It's on.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Admiral, for an excellent talk. Very, very informative and very educative. I've got a very, jumping from all this great high-tech complex topics that we've talked about, I've got a very mundane question, and that is about national interests. What are national interests? I mean, we will be talking about having the service also for 40 years, but nobody defined what is our national interest. Is it something which is cast in stone, or is it something which changes from time as the uncertain world order changes? What are we trying to protect? This is what I'm guessing now. Thank you, sir.
Basically, what you're alluding to is articulation of what our national interests are in the public domain. That is what you are referring to, sir. All of us are aware there is a core national interest of protecting sovereignty and all that. Okay. You have the RM's OP directive in which the national interests are defined, but it's a classified document which is not shared with the public. Some work was done on articulating national security strategy. The document is ready. I think it's just a matter of time, but I'm quite sure that this will be published and the organization, this will lay out all that you are leading to. I'll leave it at that, sir.
Dr. Roshan, please. I'll come back to you, ma'am. I have got the sequence. You will get it here, absolutely. Then there is a general, then it's your turn.
Capabilities we want to build. How we are going to.
you're right that as a percentage of GDP, the share of the defense budget has been falling. There is a lot which is not included in that percentage, which is also part of defense expenditure. If you include everything, it is over 2%. You're also right that the differential which is there of defense expenditure between China and us is at least 5 times. Their modernization budget is greater than our defense budget. And the capability differential is only increasing or only widening. But we have to be cognizant of the socio-economic responsibility and the conditions in the country and how much money the government of the day can allot to the defense sector and the defense budget. There is a crying need for increasing the share of the defense budget as a percentage of GDP. And this case has been made out by all the three service headquarters and HQIDs for a number of years for increasing the allocation so that the modernization of the three forces can be taken forward.
Yes, sir, I am.
Sir, I have a question with regard to the strategic partnership that we have with various countries. Is it possible to have strategic partnership with a country where your own national interests are somewhat important? For example, I think we have strategic partnership with the United States. We also have strategic partnership with Russia. Now the same steps will be towards the United States. But our national interests, for example, we were taking oil from Iran. Now, because of the sanctions, now that oil purchased from Iran has been stopped. Whether USA will meet that requirement from within their own oil reserve is a matter of conjecture. Second, let's take Afghanistan. Unilaterally, I mean, there was a plot between the Taliban and the United States. We also have some strategic interest in Afghanistan. So my question really is on whether in choosing our partners, do we compromise our national interests? Or do we meet the other guys' requirements than ours. Sometimes this is a matter of apprehension which comes to our mind. Thank you.
Okay. No, every country has its core national interest, so do we have. Okay. I think the government of the day has done a remarkable job in balancing our interests and requirements. You have basically alluded on, talked about your question revolves on energy security. Okay. It's a fact that we are a net importer of energy and we will continue to be a net importer of energy unless we discover oil in very large amounts within our country or offshore. When you have a country of the stature of the United States, is going to look at its core national interests. Okay. And you alluded about sanctions on Iran. There are also sanctions on Russia. The issue of Kaksa, which is there. So we have to work around what is happening in the global geopolitics and geostrategic. And you've done a good job, like even when the case of oil and the sanctions in Iran, the Americans have come forward and saying that whatever imports you are doing from Iran, we will make good, and already transshipment of oil which is taking place from the United States
to India. I think the first lot of tankers have already come to our shores a couple of months back. So there is no shortage of energy or this thing within our country. We've done a remarkable job of making up the slack which is there because of sanctions which are being imposed. And this game will have to be played. There's no doubt about that. And we'll have to balance our needs and requirements.
Ma'am, finally. But I've gone exactly as per the...
I'm Akrita. I work with the Times Network. Sir, in the lecture you made a fleeting reference to the proposed idea of CDS. I wanted you to elaborate on that. Is it an idea whose time has come? That was one. And the second point that I really earnestly wanted to ask, I think he posed the question of coastal security. There's been a recent news of intelligence input that there was a abandoned boat or something like that close to Gujarat, and there might be some infiltrators might have gotten in and planned an attack on the Gujarat side. Could you elaborate on these 2 points, sir?
No, the abandoned boat in the Kutch region is nothing new. There are abandoned boats which happen every time and now. Okay. The border which has been drawn up is only 70 years old, but the fishing community which occupy that land has lived there for centuries. So fishing across borders take place, and these abandoned fishing boats are there. Okay, so I think there is more media hype on this one abandoned fishing boat than it really deserves. I'll put it that. Regarding CDS, it's taken some time for this question to come. I thought it would be the first one which would be here. Okay. I'm not going to go into the historical background of it. In 2017, the three services agreed on something called the Permanent Chair and Chiefs of Staff, and we had defined the roles and responsibility of the Permanent Chair and Chiefs of Staff. Okay. Now the government announced the appointment of the Chief of Defence Staff. I'm quite sure the three service headquarters have been working together on the role and responsibilities of what the CDS should be. In my opinion, the CDS should be more than a Permanent Chair and Chiefs of Staff. I think the first thing is CDS or the service headquarters and H2IDS should be put in Schedule 1, where the Chief of Defence Staff should be responsible for the defence of India. Okay. And it should be on the incumbent who is appointed of how what the roles to take it forward, and ultimately we should have an organisation where the operational responsibility of the Defence of India should devolve on the CDS, and what operational structures are required to be put in place should be formulated by the first appointed CDS and take it forward.
Anyone else, please introduce yourself and then it's on.
I'm Colonel Nisa Siti, retired, and presently the CEO of South Institute of Advanced Studies, Calicut. I have only one question, sir. With the present economic slowdown and also the banking crisis, you know, what are the likely impact on us, basically, as well as the partnerships are concerned, and also the likely budget allocation? How are they going to impact? Thank you, sir.
Over the last three financial years, whatever allocations were made to the defense budget, there were no withdrawal or taking back of money at the RE stage in December. Okay. In the present financial year, there has been no substantial increase in the defense budget. It has kept pace with inflation. There has been an overall increase about 6 to 7%. Am I right? 6%. Okay. And whatever the state of the economy is, I'm quite sure that at the RE stage there will be no money which will be removed from the defense budget. So there won't be any surrender or withdrawal of money. We may not get additional allocation at the RE stage.
Sir, please, with my
question.
So just introduce yourself for the benefit of others. I know you, but others.
Rear Admiral Ravi. Question. You mentioned about the joint interoperability in the international arena, illustrated with one joint logistic node with USA, and second, interoperability of our helicopters with ships of other navies. My few micro level questions are, first is, roadmap for intra-service integration of logistics. Two is, taking up into account our developing commitments in the Indo-Pacific, are we working on any arrangement of interoperability of Indian naval aircraft from aircraft carriers of friendly navies, whether it be US, whether it be French, Japanese, or thank you.
So, last comment first, that is interoperability of aircrafts, okay, especially deck-based fighters. Okay. Both the US are all catapult-launched aircraft, where the MiG-29K, which is a deck-based fighter, is a roll-on takeoff through a ski jump and an arrestor landing, so it's not compatible with that bomb, so that is not going to happen. If you want to have interoperability of deck-based fighters, you need to have fighters which have the capability to be launched by a catapult. Okay. Helicopters are interoperable. There is no issue of that. We already signed the hostag. You can operate from any other. Whoever signed signatories to the hostag, now you don't need to have a separate arrangement for the helicopters to go and land. Okay. You talked about joint logistic node. When I was referring to the joint logistic node, I was talking to the joint logistic node within the three services. Okay. I'm not talking about joint logistic node with the United States. So we have a joint logistic node in the Andaman and Nicobar Command. There is a joint logistic node in the Northeast and one in Mumbai, which is going to look at the logistic needs. These are pilot projects to look at the needs of the three services. Okay. So I have joint structures on that. Under LIMOVA, which is signed by the United States, there are similar agreements which have been signed with other countries. So you have logistic arrangements which are available for all the three services to tap into. Okay. You also talked about the Indo-Pacific and ships are interoperable. Okay. With signing of COMCASA, now you will have common communication kits which will be there. Should you be able to share a common picture, communicate with each other. So, with these kits coming on board, you will be able to communicate with all US partners, say all NATO countries which have a common this thing, and all the United States equipment. Like the P8I Boeing will now be equipped with US communication kit, so you will be able to share your picture and communicate with the P-8 Boeing of the United States. So these things are already happening. So to a large extent, especially on the Navy side, we are interoperable with a large number of navies. Basically, problem is be able to communicate to each other and share a common operational picture. So the work is on in this, and so is the case in the case of the Air Force and Army.
So you wanted to have another... Okay, that was the last question after that.
Sorry, coming back again. You raised the issue of the CDS. It is a welcome step. We have been asking for it. The issue now, the statement that you made was that he is responsible for the defense of the country.
That's my opinion, sir.
Yes. There is something floating around on the WhatsApp that the committee of Vivekananda, I think, foundation, they had a meeting of some senior people, and somehow they have gone to suggest that the Raksha Mantri should be the the role now for the defense of the country. Should the CDS be responsible? Or the Raksha Mantri should be responsible? Or should the defense secretary? In my view, the CDS now becomes senior to the defense secretary in any case. And therefore, he becomes the Raksha Mantri, being a political leader, cannot be vested with such a responsibility. Is that.
So ultimately it is the responsibility of the Raksha Mantri to be for the defense of the country. Okay, there's no doubt about that in my mind. It's the responsibility for the defense of the country should rest with the Raksha Mantri. Okay. When you're looking at a lower rung, what I was suggesting is the defense of the country should rest with the CDS. There is an implementation committee which has been appointed, which has been formed for the appointment of the CDS. The chairman, chiefs of staff committee is a member of that committee. That committee has met once, and I think they are going to take this process of appointment of the CDS and its role and responsibility forward. I think the army chief can throw more light on it because I am now out of office.
The last question,
Good afternoon, sir. My name is Oliver Gonsalves. I'm an associate fellow in the AMF. My question is to Admiral Lanba. So you were talking about creating a niche, an area for niche technology capacity in Indian industry. In light of the small drone, unconfirmed drone attacks on petroleum facilities in Saudi Arabia, how prepared are we, our armed forces, to meet this challenge, this drone challenge?
The air defense of the country is the responsibility of the Indian Air Force.
Okay.
So there is a surveillance grid and a surveillance network of radars, and the VAs and VPs have been identified which are required to be protected, and there are systems available both in the form of sensor grid, fighter aircrafts and AD systems and networks. So it's there in place. Okay.
I think we'll stop the questions, the session over here, and now I'm not going to do any summing up. That's the Army Chief is going to give his concluding remarks. But before that, can I just add, with your permission, say something. I think one of the issues that we do, which is, the USA, as you all are aware, interacts with large number of institutions here and abroad. One of the issues that has been coming up always, which we don't seem to be discussing here, is India's capability in space, cyber, nuclear and missile technology. And the world looks at it very seriously and looks at us as powers over there. So when we look at military capabilities, it's not just the Army, Navy, Air Force. The world is looking at us and saying we are capable in certain fields which have a very important role, which have a very important this thing in matters military. The second issue which has been coming up in the last few conferences, including the Seoul Defense Dialogue, which I just where the RM gave the keynote address. I was a panelist in one of the panels. I've been going there for the last 4 years. One of the issues which keeps coming up is also looking, which came up in the last, this year, post or actually started coming up after 2016 when we did the surgical strike, and thereafter when Doklam happened, people have been looking around and saying that there has been a robust response and the armed forces of the country will have to be prepared a little differently than what we were. And of course we do reassure, and I'm sure we are all at least out of the system, but I'm sure the services have taken note of it and will be fully prepared to be acting to be in that particular mode, because they expect that your mode, you cannot now have a different mode. That mode is accepted. As a matter of fact, one of the questions asked was, will you also now protect your interests in offshore drilling drills which you have got somewhere else outside your own country, this thing? So I think we will be looking around beyond just not only our borders, and that will be happening. So with these comments now, I'll request General Bipin Rawat, Chief of the Army Staff, to please make his concluding remarks. Would you like to say something before that, sir?
I can say, in response to what General, the Director has said,
Actually, when he looked at, when I was a naval chief in the initial this thing, when I became the chairman chiefs of staff, I had asked the naval headquarters to find out what were the processes which were there for the 71 war. And we discovered in the file that there was a common op order signed off by the three chiefs and the chairman chiefs of staff. So it's not that there's something new and we're not on the same page. So taking off from that, in the last 3 years, the three services have sat together. We've integrated, drawn out contingencies and ops plans, and it held us in good stead when Balakot happened. So we are very much there. Only thing, we don't talk about it. Okay.
Admiral Sunil Lanba, Air Chief Marshal S.P. Tyagi, Shri and Srimati Sardari Lal, General P.K. Singh, the Director USI, veterans present here from the Defence Services, the Foreign and the Administrative Services, officers in uniform, ladies and gentlemen. I think Admiral Lanba has covered three different topics in a very erudite, clear and concise manner. You know, he's spoken about building military capability, he spoke about developing new partnerships, and finally protecting national interests, all in an uncertain global order. He gave it a skeleton. He then added the meat to the subject. And I think during the question and answer session, he's also brought the goat to the table. So all that remains for me to do is to share the meat with you, and let's enjoy this feast. The manner in which he covered these three topics which have relevance with each other, I think has highlighted that there is a need to protect our national interests. We have to start looking at developing partnerships. A lot of these issues also came up during the question answer session. And then how do we go about building military capability to protect our national interests? I think today the USI has very aptly chosen this very relevant and contemporary subject to honor Colonel Pyara Lal, who's been the director of this great institution, and he's brought this institution to where it stands today. You know, a stable world order in today's environment is a rare phenomena. Inevitably, even the best managed orders do come to an end. So the timing and manner in which the ending happens may not always be predictable. This happens when the so-called balance of power becomes imbalanced as a result of changing capacities, altering will, and growing ambitions. Some entities are bound to fall while others may rise. The liberal international order propagated by the West, which is based on democratic principles, committed to civil and human rights, accountability to citizens, bound by the rule of law, and focused on economic prosperity for all, somehow seems to be losing its true relevance. Today, in an uncertain multipolar world order, we are witnessing myriad challenges, rising threats of hybrid warfare, new conflict zones appearing in various parts of the world, and terrorism mounting an omnipresent threat makes the situation even more complicated. With the growing power shifts that are taking place, today's world order has struggled to cope with all these. China's rise, appearance of several medium powers such as North Korea, which reject order in the emergence of non-state actors from drug cartels to terrorist networks, pose a serious threat to order within and between states. The technological and political context have also changed. Globalization itself has had destabilizing effects ranging from climate change to the spread of technology into far more hands than ever before, including groups and people intent on disrupting this order. Nationalism and populism have surged as a result of greater inequality within nations. Job losses caused by trade and technology, increased flow of migrants and refugees, and the power of social media to spread hate and violence. Status of European Union and Brexit is a direct result of all these factors. Efforts to build frameworks to deal with the challenges of globalization, climate change and cyber attacks have come up. The United States have taken a step from maintaining global order. I would say a step back from maintaining the global order. Doubts about USA's reliability have multiplied owing to its voluntary withdrawal from numerous international pacts and commitments in Europe and in Asia, growing geopolitical clout of China and consequent strategic competition with the US has already manifested in the form of US-China trade and technology war and is severely impacting global economies, including ours. As technological innovation becomes the primary source of wealth, countries are likely to become even more protective to their intellectual property. Many countries are tightening control over capital flows to brace for an anticipated global economic slump. China's brazen approach in the South China Sea, continuing crises in Afghanistan, Iran, North Korea, Pakistan as an epicenter of terrorism, ISIS brand of terrorists surfacing even in distant island nations like New Zealand are but just a few threats that the world and India will continue to be confronted with unless we deal with these head on. Today, deterring aggression has become increasingly difficult due to current technological and geopolitical developments. The era of unprecedented US and military dominance has ended, leading to renewed competition between them and the revisionist powers, China and Russia. Military competition is expanding to several new domains, from space and cyber to the seabed. New capabilities are making it harder to accurately gauge the balance of power. Taken together, these developments lead to an inescapable conclusion. The greatest strategic challenge of the current era is neither the return of great power rivalries nor the spread of advanced weaponries. It is the erosion of deterrence. Cyber weapons, with their enormous but untested potential to corrupt a state's early warning and command systems, muddy the waters of deterrence even further. Today's major powers have built their economic and military might on a vast but vulnerable network of satellites, as well as undersea cables. National economies rely on satellites for a wide range of services. Economies and militaries rely on the internet and almost all transoceanic data flows from undersea cables. Unfortunately, this entire infrastructure is susceptible to disruption, and deterring against aggression against it is not going to be easy. Quickly identifying and retaliating against an aggressor is far more difficult today. And because so many states and non-state actors are capable of operating effectively in these relatively new domains, attribution becomes even more complicated. Having seen the complexity of ever-changing world order, building and realigning of partnerships or alliances and the erosion of deterrence, keeping focus on our own national interests is an intricate and complicated task. National interests are and shall always remain supreme. Partnerships today are increasingly based on a nation's understanding of its national interests. Shared interests and common goals, even with adversarial nations are in some cases leading to development of partnerships. There are instances when partnerships have been forged on neither shared goals nor ideals, but just on nations' interests. How strong these partnerships are, or how long will they endure, shall be governed by nations' national interests and continuation of the meeting of minds. However, one thing is for sure, and that as the world gets multipolar, it shall move towards developing new partnerships. India historically has desisted from international partnerships owing to its erstwhile policy of non-alignment. However, we have now well understood the necessity of developing strategic partnerships with friendly nations. India now proactively engages in developing new age partnerships with a host of nations based on shared interests in economic, security and strategic domain. The present government has left no stone unturned and has engaged with nations not just in our neighborhood but across the world. With some fledgling and some nascent partnerships, India is well on its path to develop cooperation in the multiple fields of diplomatic, strategic, economic, energy and security. With emerging partnerships be an answer to stem this power shift and make the future world peaceful. In this context, the security dynamics are replete with strategically unpredictability and multi-spectrum warfare challenges. Ladies and gentlemen, war is a very complex phenomenon with ever-evolving dimension. This mandates the Indian Armed Forces to be prepared to face a wide ranging of threats with varying levels of intensity. Therefore, building military capability is undeniably the sine qua non for us. Keeping the long term in perspective, developing indigenous military capability is therefore the answer. We have all discussed about developing weapon systems, ammunition, equipment through self-reliance. I think that is the need of the hour. And during the question-answer session, it emerged that we have to now focus on our indigenization through our private industry. Yes, it is very much the need of the hour. The basic issue stems from the problem of investment in research and development. Is the industry today capable or willing to invest in R&D without assured orders? How do we then give assured orders to an industry where you have to bank on a three-tier system of looking at who is the lowest bidder, who has the better technology? Do we give preference to technology or to cost? So these are some of the issues and challenges that we will continue to face. I think we've been speaking about developing indigenous system. We are well on our way heading towards this kind of a thing. The issue is, do we have the capacity to absorb technologies? There are countries around the world who are willing to transfer their technologies to us, but where is the base to imbibe this technology? Therefore, I think industry has to focus to a greater extent on research and development. Can they do it alone? The answer is yes and no. Not every industry has the capacity to develop the kind of resources that are required in development, developing technologies, imbibing the kind of technological advancements that the other nations have, that they are willing to share with us. Therefore, is there a need for the government to step in? Yes, in partiality. Some kind of infusion of funds in the industry for research and development, other than the DRDO alone, is the need of the hour. A lot of effort is therefore being put in towards this through the Make One and Make Two procedures. Make One procedures that the government has now adopted allow some kind of sharing of costs with the industry. And Make Two procedures are those where the industry is willing to go on its own to develop technology and give us the equipment. I would just wish to highlight that, you know, when the weapon systems were being developed, it is not that the private industry does not have the capacity to develop small arms in our country. But the issue is again of technology. Why did we have to go in for a AK-203 coming in from Russia? Because they have superior metallurgy. And through metallurgy comes accuracy. Same thing happens to why, what are we, what is happening with our tanks? We are trying to develop the armored fighting vehicles indigenously. We cannot even today develop an engine. Can the industry only go ahead and develop a 1500 horsepower engine which can propel this 50 ton monster through the kind of terrain which we are expected to operate? If that can be developed, we can give to the private industry the capacity to build tanks in India. We are looking at a future ready combat vehicle. But before that, the engine is what is required. Can you develop that engine? Today we are importing all these engines from abroad. Along with it comes the other structures. Now let me also tell you that everything that is done in the country, whether it is being done by the DPSUs or the ordnance factories, around the DPSUs there are a lot of small and medium enterprises who are benefiting. Even the ISRO, which has now sent the Chandrayaan 2 into space, had about 2,000 small and medium enterprises which helped them develop the Chandrayaan. It is not that the private industry in the country is not being supported. The private industry is being supported, but it is through small scale technologies that they are able to come up with. To develop large technologies, imbibe technologies, the need of the hour is investment in R&D. And I think if that can happen, we will be able to develop good weapon systems in our country. You will be happy to learn that only day for yesterday, we have floated the requirement of developing our own ammunition for our tanks with the private industry. It is the AP-FSDS ammunition which we have been importing from Russia will now be manufactured by the private industry. A contract for 85,000 rounds of this ammunition has already been given to the industry. Out of which, in addition to that, 10,000 rounds will also be developed by DRDO. So that concurrently we can see, it's actually challenging the DRDO to come out with good product because they know the industry is now also is going to give them a challenge. So the way forward is, let the ordnance factories work, but concurrently with them, allow the industry to also develop similar systems so that they get challenged into producing better stuff that we need. So that is the way forward. About the Navy and Air Force, I think the Admiral has already spoken. Now looking at how the structures for the military have to develop, I think there are, to develop military capability, you have to look at two issues. One is developing structures, which I think is already happening. Spoken about the CDS and what the role and charter for the CDS will be. I mean, there is a body which is now looking at it as to what should be the role and responsibility. Let them do their work and let's see what comes out with. Is the ultimate decision what is taken by the government. I don't think we should rely too much on the social media on what is coming out. It is not true. The next issue is developing our capacities and capabilities. I think future wars will not be wars of attrition. We have to be prepared to fight the war in the cyber domain. There will be cartographic aggressions. There will be legal warfare. We will have to be concerned about information warfare and artificial intelligence. And to top it all, we will need capabilities from space for providing us the much needed intelligence, surveillance and reconnaissance requirements. So these are the needs of the hour which we have to look at. Taking the message further on artificial intelligence, a lot of work has been done, as was also brought out by the former CISC, as to how this is moving forward. But I think artificial intelligence will not help us in winning wars. It will only remain a force multiplier. And let me tell you, in the case of the armed forces, this will mainly support logistic functions. Operational logistic functions will mainly be supported by artificial intelligence. It will not serve as a tool for war fighting and giving you plans up front as to how you should fight war. For that, you still need military minds and you need leadership, which is to be trained in making decisions. Because if artificial intelligence could do your decision making, you wouldn't need senior leadership. Anybody can take the position of a senior leader. I think that is something which we have to understand, that artificial intelligence, information warfare, cyber warfare, anything that you have will only be support systems for modern war fighting. Wars will still be fought by the men on ground, soldiers, sailors and airmen, and with the machines that are made available to them in times to come. You know, talking about how the defense industry is developing, we have for too long denied ourselves the capability of the industry, allowed only some of the DPSUs and ordnance factories to provide us our wherewithal for war fighting, but I think things have now changed. Our industry is now becoming export oriented, and let me tell you, just last year we have exported military hardware to tune of 10,000 crores. And this year the proposed budget is around 25,000 crores. It is not just bulletproof jackets. It is much more than that. So we are now looking at becoming an export-oriented industry, taking support from the civilian industry as well, and with our DRDO providing them support and some support coming in from the R&D from within the industry. So I think there is light at the end of the tunnel, and let me assure you that things are moving in the positive direction. And therefore, as we wind up today's proceedings, I must say that we are fortunate to have heard Admiral Sunil Lanba, the former chief of the naval staff, in the very erudite and articulate manner in which he put across his things. I wish to also compliment the USI for the most professional conduct of today's event, a very contemporary subject, and I think it is a true tribute to Colonel Pyara Lal for what he has done for this great institute and organization. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Ladies and gentlemen, all that remains for me is to thank Admiral Sunil Lanba and General Bipin Rawat and request them to please accept the USI memento for being here with us. May I request you, sir, to please accept the USI memento. Ladies and gentlemen, may I please request you to join us for refreshments? Thank you very much for being here.